Warm welcome. So over the next 45 minutes, I'm going to be speaking about assessment of amblyopia, what to look out for. So first, I would begin with some warm acknowledgements to the team behind not just this presentation, but the entire work that happens in the binocular vision clinic. So the first is to my entire team, and a specific mention to three people who helped in making this presentation and preparing the multimedia files. And Ms. Archaita Rakshit, who specifically helped a lot when we were trying to establish the amblyopia clinic in Shankar Nethralaya. To the entire CyberSight team, Orbis India, a specific mention to Dr. Rishi for really coordinating the entire show, and Ms. Sushweta. To all our patients and the pediatric ophthalmology department of SN, because we work together with so much synergy that we are able to accomplish so much, and to all my mentors in the department, and a special mention to my mentor, Professor Michelle Scheinman, who's taught so much in this area. And this is my beautiful team that is here. So this is the overview of today's presentation. And this is the famous Hippocratic quote. I tried to find the authenticity of this quote, but unfortunately I couldn't. But whatever it is, we all like this quote. So when the doctor sees nothing and the patient sees nothing, the diagnosis is amblyopia. So amblyopia still remains as a diagnosis of exclusion. And I would, take time to really acknowledge these two people who contributed a lot in the understanding of neurophysiology of amblyopia, especially in the very early years. In the 1960s at the Harvard Medical School, that David Hubel and Torsten Wiesel, in the Department of Neurobiology, they tried to understand development of ocular dominance columns and how the vision develops in an immature brain, and what are the effects of occlusion or patching, and say that, and so they used kittens. And single cell recordings were done as early as 1960s to understand this. And they, of course, got Nobel Prize for their expert opinion in this area. So a lot of our current understanding draws back from the work done by David Hubel and Torsten Wiesel. So amblyopia is derived from two Greek words, amblyo meaning dull and opia meaning vision. So amblyopia meaning dullness of vision. And the famous definition given by Professor Juan Lurden that we keep studying from the very beginning in optometry and ophthalmology is decrease of visual acuity caused by abnormal binocular interaction that can occur in one or both eyes. And there are certain important components to this definition. Number one is any deprivation should happen within the critical period, and there should not be any specific cause that is detected during the eye examination. And when we detect this early, we should be able to reverse it by appropriate therapeutic measures. So basically, any visual impairment due to abnormal visual development in early life is a potential risk factor for amblyopia. But there are also other risk factors that are mentioned here, including preterm birth, low birth weight, ROP, cerebral palsy, any developmental delay, family history of amblyopia, any organic pathologies, and maternal factors such as smoking or antihistamine ingestion and alcohol. But amblyopia can be present even in the absence of these risk factors. From a functional perspective, beyond visual acuity, if we want to characterize amblyopia, this is one of my favorite definitions that Dr. Lisa Asper has given in her paper, where she defines amblyopia as a visual cacophony of deficits, not just limited to visual acuity, but in contrast sensitivity, spatial localization, fixation, ocular motility, accommodation, crowding, attention, motion perception, and temporal processing. Now, why do we have to understand amblyopia in so much detail is because the testing that we would do when a patient with amblyopia comes to us and the appropriate therapy or treatment modalities that we want to cater to, depending upon the deficits that we identify in these areas, definitely, we need to have an understanding of what really happens in amblyopia beyond visual acuity. So the preferred practice pattern guidelines by the American Academy of Ophthalmology proposes these diagnostic criteria for amblyopia, as you would see here, which is in case of unilateral amblyopia, if there is a objection to monocular occlusion or if there is a specific fixation preference, and if there is an interocular difference of two or more octaves. So basically, if we are dealing with pre-verbal kids, we would be using preferential looking tests like the Teller Acuity cards or the Cardiff tests. And if a child shows a difference of more than four card difference between the two eyes, then that means, like, you know, there's a two octave difference. So if we see an interocular difference of two or more octaves or an interocular acuity difference of two or more lines, best corrected visual acuity, then that is suggestive of unilateral amblyopia. When it comes to best corrected visual acuity, of course, we need to have age corrected norms. So as you would see here, there are different norms that are proposed for different age groups, beginning from 3 to more than 5. So you would use a criteria of 6 by 9 or 20 by 30 only when the child crosses the age of 5. And depending on etiology, okay, you can classify amblyopia as follows. The first being strabismic, which is, of course, when the strabismus is constant and it's not alternating. The second being refractive. So the three classifications to this, number one being a difference in refractive error between the two eyes by more than 1.5 diopters, or an astigmatic component, which is represented by meridional amblyopia, or a bilateral high refractive errors, which is termed as isoemetropic amblyopia. The third is visual deprivation due to any kind of organic pathologies, including media opacity, such as congenital cataract or lenticular opacities, or even a congenital ptosis. The last one is occlusion amblyopia, where when in the process of occlusion for amblyopia treatment, the good eye or the better eye develops amblyopia. And if there are more than one etiology to amblyopia, then we would call it a combined mechanism amblyopia. So that is based on etiology. So far we did see the visual acuity criteria. We did see about the etiology based classification. Now, based on severity of visual acuity, PDIG has proposed this particular classification. So earlier we used to call this a shallow, moderate, or deep amblyopia, but then it is preferred to be called as mild, moderate, and severe. So the 20 by 25 cut, the 20 cutoffs have been like converted to 6 by because, like, you know, of the systems that we follow here. So as you would see here, these are the different visual acuity levels that you need to be using when you want to classify amblyopia based on the visual acuity. Now, when we want to, you know, prescribe for amblyopia especially, definitely we need to be aware of the refractive correction guidelines. So this is again the guidelines given by the American Academy of Ophthalmology based on the consensus that they arrived at. And as you would see here, again, these are age-based guidelines for myopia, hyperopia, hyperopia with esotropia and astigmatism. And whenever there is an anisometropia, definitely the thresholds are much more lower, which means that even if the refractive error is lesser, you would go ahead and prescribe because the child has an added risk of now anisometropia coming into the picture. Now, when there is an additional strabismic component, especially when there is hyperopia, there is generally no, you don't look at cutoffs, you would go ahead and prescribe the full cycloplegic correction in such cases. So these can serve as useful references to optometrists when you want to deal with, you know, look at refractive error and find if they are potentially amblyogenic or not. But again, you have to look at the holistic picture, not just one at a time. So I will just, as we go through the presentation, tell you what I mean by that. Now let's look at an example here. Say, as you see in this picture, a one-year-old child comes to us with complaints of constant, is brought with complaints of constant inward deviation since 4 months of age. And this is the cycloplegic refraction value, which is about plus 2 diopters. And the fixation assessment shows that the child resists occlusion of the right eye. So the child does not want you to occlude the right eye. So in this particular case, if I have to ask you, what type of amblyopia is this? So request Sushmita to launch the poll. So in this, you can, so in this particular case scenario, what is the potential ambliogenic risk factor that you are able to identify, and how would you classify amblyopia? Awesome. So most of you have given the right answer. So as you see here, we are talking about a one-year-old child for whom the plus 2 diopter cycloplegic refraction value that we showed here is potentially considered normal for the age. And so in this case, the amblyogenic risk factor is supposed to be strabismic. And so strabismic amblyopia would be the more appropriate answer in this case. And most of you have got it right. So that's good. And let's move on to the next scenario. Let's see how many of you are able to get this based on the etiology. So now this is a 4-year-old child who is referred from a school vision screening program for further management. And as you would see here, the visual acuity in the right eye is 6/18. Left eye is 6/9. The near visual acuities are normal. There is no strabismus that you're able to identify. And this is the cycloplegic refraction value. So a plus 1.5 diopters with 4 diopter cylinder. Axis 180 in the right eye. And left eye is plus 1.5 diopter sphere with half a diopter cylinder. Axis 180 in the left eye. So take a look at this. Now, if I want you to classify this amblyopia, what could potentially be the type of amblyopia for this particular case scenario? Okay. So some of you have answered meridional, some of you have answered anisometropic. Anisometropic is definitely not a wrong answer though. Yeah. So meridional amblyopia is a more appropriate answer because we are looking at anisometropia due to astigmatism in this particular case. So meridional amblyopia is the more appropriate answer. So you can still classify it as anisometropic, but prefer to use the word meridional. And I just got to look at one of the questions in the question and answer section, though I would like to answer it towards the end. I thought that's more relevant at this point. So some of you wanted me to simplify the definition for amblyopia more. So what I wanted to tell you is that amblyopia is, you cannot define amblyopia like when there is a visual, deprivation, or when there is a visual impairment for which you are not able to identify the cause. So that's what used to be the older definition. And or some people would say that any visual acuity of less than 6/9, you can call it amblyopia if there are no physical causes that can be detected during an eye examination. So that was what used to be earlier definitions. But now we are re-looking at the definitions and we are saying that you cannot define amblyopia just based on one visual acuity cutoff or based on an interocular difference in acuity by more than 2 lines. Okay, so you can still use the definition of less than 6/9 or greater than 2 lines of interocular acuity difference. These two are standard definitions. But beyond that, amblyopia also has many other pathophysiological aspects involved into the definition. That's what I wanted to tell you. So with that, let's move on to the clinical investigations, which are more relevant for optometrists basically, as when a child or an adult with amblyopia comes to you, what should you be assessing or what should you be looking for? So I have categorized the whole assessment into 3 areas. The number one is basic testing, which is done as part of a routine ophthalmic examination for every person, not just for amblyopes, but for every person. And then comes specific tests, which I have categorized it as monocular and binocular components. Let's first look at the basic testing before we jump on to the rest two. So in the basic testing, as you see, history taking is the most important aspect. I'll just highlight some of the key questions that you might have to focus upon when you are taking history for a child with amblyopia. And then, of course, your visual acuity, which is basically, I've mentioned it as high contrast, because when we measure our Snellen visual acuity or our ATDRS Logmar visual acuity, we are only measuring the 100% contrast at the high spatial frequency cutoff. We are not really looking at any other contrast levels. And the next thing is cycloplegic refraction, very, very important. So before we really diagnose amblyopia, before we want to decide about the refractive prescription, a cycloplegic refraction is mandatory, and of course a dilated fundus examination. I would also want to emphasize upon keratometry or measurement of corneal curvature that you can do either using a manual keratometry, or now autorefractors do come with an inbuilt keratometry, so you can use that to document corneal curvature in amblyopes, especially as you saw in the case two, that was a meridional amblyopia. So you wanted to really correlate your refraction with the corneal curvature values that come up. So you, it's important to document keratometry. The second thing is keratometry also helps you to determine the accurate axis, because in children, many times when you do a refraction, you may not be able to refine your JCC and arrive at the appropriate axis. But prescription of the cylindrical correction at the right axis is very important in the treatment of amblyopia. Even if you are going to make a 5 degrees error when you are prescribing high cylinders, that's going to impact the visual acuity of the child. So it's very important to be accurate when it comes to documenting the cylindrical axis and the magnitude. Then some of the monocular tests I have mentioned here are the standard assessment of fixation. I will anyway talk about it in detail. Then the contrast sensitivity measurements and ocular accommodation. Under binocular tests, your sensory and motor assessments and certain additional tests I have mentioned here, which some of you might be familiar with, but some of you may not. So I'll talk about that in detail as well. And then there is an ancillary testing component that I have put here, which I feel is like, in some cases, when you want to understand amblyopia in detail, or when it comes to the whole management of myopia, especially like amblyopes who are progressing, myopic amblyopes who are progressing, or even hyperopic amblyopes who are rapidly emmetropizing, even documenting ocular biometry is very important for the clinician to be able to know, like, you know, what really happens in the axial length and other ocular structures. And reading speed and other supplemental testing. Supplemental testing like ERG or OCT to rule out any other potential underlying causes that can mimic amblyopia. So if the child is on patching and visual acuity is not improving beyond a certain level, visual acuity is plateaued and we have ruled out every other cause, then are we missing out something? So these are supplemental tests that could actually add more value in the process. But moving ahead with history taking, so these are some of the aspects that you want to make a note of. Number one, as we already saw, any child with a family history of amblyopia, either in parents or in siblings, is at a high risk of amblyopia. And the developmental milestones, children with developmental disabilities and delayed developments are at high risk of amblyopia. And if they have already been diagnosed with amblyopia and if they are under treatment for amblyopia, then it's important to know at what age the diagnosis was made, which eye is amblyopic, what is the history of previous treatment that they have undergone so far, including refractive correction or penalization through occlusion or pharmacological penalization or any active vision therapy treatment modalities that they have followed. And very important is how compliant they were to any of the treatments that were proposed by previous practitioners. And that's going to give you an idea as if you are going to initiate some treatment, how compliant they will be, or should we modify the treatment protocol. And if they are on a patching regimen, then what type of patch, how many hours, how compliant they are, do they do any additional activities when the patch is on, and does the child have any specific difficulty in navigating around, or overall in terms of their quality of life, do they have any specific difficulty when they are on the patch? So these things need to get into the history when you are specifically investigating for amblyopia. The next thing is, as I already mentioned, getting a proper refraction. I cannot emphasize more on this, but to be super skilled with your retinoscopy as well as in your cycloplegic refraction, and getting your subjective acceptance done in older amblyopes or any child who is cooperative. Sometimes we believe that children are not cooperative, but we need not assume that. Wherever possible, a subjective acceptance can be definitely tried. And so when it comes to cycloplegic refraction, I was about to tell you that staying on axis is very important, because most of the times errors can happen in refraction when you go off axis because of dilated pupils. And this can also result in errors in the axis of cylindrical prescription. So it's super important to be very accurate and skilled with your cycloplegic refraction. So the next thing is moving ahead with your visual acuity testing. So I'm not going to really dive deep into this, because I understand that all of you are quite familiar in checking visual acuity, like using age-appropriate visual acuity tests. So I just mentioned some of the commonly used tests, especially when we are dealing with children of different age groups. If you're dealing with a child like between 0 to 3 years, then you could use any of the preferential looking tests or your OKN or the Lea's Impulse and the HOTV is agreed upon as a gold standard or standard test in amblyopia assessment. And if the child is greater than 3 years, then you could use your ETDRS, your Snellen, Lea's Impulse or HOTV. But I would highly recommend that use a standard visual acuity chart if possible. Like use a Lea's Impulse that uses logarithmic principle, logMAR principle or an ETDRS chart. And the illiterate E and Landol C, of course, needs a sense of direction, directional understanding from the child. So usually children up to 7, 7.5 years, they don't really get the directional understanding like so accurate. So you might want to like, you know, delay the use of these tests until they turn 7, 7.5. But you can go ahead and use your other picture-based or letter-based matching cards or whatever, whichever is appropriate. But visual acuity is the starting point in amblyopia diagnosis. So getting an accurate estimate of visual acuity is very important. Number one. Number two is, of course, when the child comes for regular follow-ups, it's always important to check the amblyopic eye's visual acuity first and to change the charts also, because kids are very, very shrewd. They tend to memorize your visual acuity charts. So it's very important to, you know, change the charts or use computer-based charts. That randomizes the letter presentation. So that's your standard ETDRS letter charts. So if you see these as I told the Lea's Impulse or the standard ETDRS, the spacing of the letters and between the letters and between the lines, they all follow a logarithmic progression. So they are more appropriate when it comes to testing for visual acuity. Then these are your preferential looking cards. The most important aspect that many of us like, you know, deal with in amblyopia testing is basically crowding phenomena. So it's established that the lateral inhibitions that happen in the retina when a stimuli fall on the retina, the visual processes that happen, amblyopes have some issues with the lateral inhibition. So when you have two targets or three targets simultaneously or adjacently present, the visual system will confuse. So they might actually, you know, give poorer responses when the visual acuity, when the letters are presented together or in a crowded fashion. So this is an inherent deficit in the amblyopic visual system. But having said that, when you're going to use single symbol presentations, you have to be very cautious that that's going to overestimate the visual acuity, because now that you're removing crowding from the equation, it's going to, of course, overestimate the visual acuity. So you have to keep two things in mind. Number one, you have to use a standard visual acuity chart for measuring visual acuity. Number two, when you want to measure crowding phenomena, whether crowding is present or not, then we would recommend using, like as you see here, the same Lea symbols with a crowding bar. You can show it isolated, like the single symbol Lea that is shown here, but you can use crowding bars so that, you know, you are not really overestimating visual acuity. And then number two is, if you're using a computer-based visual acuity testing, rather than pointing out, so it's always recommended not to point out the letters because that's going to overestimate. So if kid has difficulty reading letters like continuously, you can use arrows like this and move arrows adjacently for them to focus on one letter at a time. So though it is understood that single letter visual acuity estimation is better, it's also imperative to understand that it overestimates the visual acuity. So you should be using crowding bars, and that's how you take care of the crowding phenomena in amblyopia. The next few set of tests are all to do with fixation preference. So the first is your standard fixation preference test. When I say like SFPT, which stands for standard fixation preference test. So this is basically your central steady and maintain. So what you want to do is you want to close one of the eyes and then look for the ability of the amblyopic eye to fixate. It's also important to show fine detailed targets or an accommodative target targets closer to the visual acuity of the child so that the child really fixates at the target. Or you can use colorful lights and, you know, toys, whichever that attracts the attention. So basically the child needs to fixate. Now, when you close the dominant eye or the good eye and ask the child to fixate with the amblyopic eye, what you need to look for? you need to look for if the child is able to fixate and hold the fixation for greater than 5 seconds. That indicates that the eye has normal fixation or potentially has normal visual acuity. But if the child holds only briefly or momentarily or less than 3 seconds and before it refixates to the dominant eye, then that indicates that there is a fixation preference. So this is the criteria that Dr. Wright proposed when you want to classify or when you want to look at, does the child have any fixation preference? So this is a test that you will use when the child, when you are dealing with a strabismic amblyope. So if you are dealing with a child who has either an esotropia or an exotropia, then you can use your CSM testing. But if you are dealing with a child who is anisometropic, who is apparently orthophoric, or you are dealing with a child who has microtropia, which is otherwise like a small angle strabismus less than say 8 prisms, then Wright proposes that we use what we call as the induced tropia test. And that is basically using a 10 prisms or a 12 prisms as you see here to check the preference, fixation preference. So how do you do that? So if you see here in this particular video, so I'm just holding a 12 prism base down in front of one eye and then looking for the, you know, the eye movements. So I mean, maybe because like, I don't know, because of your internet connectivity, some of you might be seeing it like catching up really slow. But as you can see, if the eye is really like, you know, see, this is a dominant eye. So you can really see that it makes a vertical movement and then comes back. But when the same vertical prism is held before the amblyopic eye, because the shift in the image that happens in the retina is happening within the like the foveal zone. And so the person is not really appreciating the diplopia. So in this case, the eye is not going to make any movements. So in this particular case, it's basically unmaintained fixation in the right eye, which is amblyopic eye, whereas the left eye is the dominant eye. And that is like, you know, showing normal fixation. Or you could go ahead and use the common 4-prism base out test, which is what we use it when we test for microtropia. So whenever you hold up 4 prisms or a prism base out, you know that the eye moves towards the apex. So what you have to look for is you put the prisms and immediately look for the movement of the eye. So now in this case, when the 4-prism base out is held in front of the amblyopic eye, you're not really seeing any movement of the eye. So I'll just play it once again. So you can look at the dominant eye. So look at the other eye. It's easy to really look at the movement that the other eye makes. So both eyes kind of like the left, the eye with the prism moves towards the nose and the other eye is making a yoked movement away from the nose. But when you're keeping the prisms in front of the amblyopic eye, you're not really able to make out any eye movements. So this is again indicative of a central suppression scotoma or a microtropia. So that's what the 4-prism base out test is going to help you with. So if there is no movement that is detected, like you keep a prism, the eye is not really appreciating the diplopic movement, then the eye is not going to make any movements. And that means it's positive. So when you say positive, it indicates that the eye is amblyopic. And when we say negative, it indicates that the eye has apparently normal fixation or does not have a central suppression scotoma. Then the last test in this category is the Bruckner's test or the red reflex test. So as you see here, we use the direct ophthalmoscopic light. You can like show the light as broad as possible such that it equally illuminates both the eyes. And the test is preferably done at a distance of 1 meter. So you dial in like high magnification and look through the direct ophthalmoscope and look at the reflex that comes, the red reflex that comes from both the eyes. And the eye that is either strabismic or anisometropic is going to show a more brighter and pale reflex. So in this case, the left eye is potentially amblyopic, but the eye that is good or non-amblyopic is going to show a more darker and more deep red reflex. Okay. So whichever eye that is going to show a pale and white reflex is indicative of amblyopia when you do a Bruckner's red reflex test. So this test can, you need to be careful when you are doing this test in microtropes, because in microtropia, you may not be able to find out, you know, it will look as if both the reflexes are of the same brightness. So for microtropia, it's always preferable to do other tests such as your 4% base out test. But this is usually applicable when there is either an anisometropic component or a strabismic component. And even in case of isometropic amblyopia, when there are high refractive errors, you just can keep going a little back than 1 meter. Like you can go up to 2 to 3 meters and you can look at the, you can figure out the crescents that come out of the, that come out through these red reflexes. And many of the current technologies like the handheld auto refraction, like the photo refractors, utilize this red reflex as an additional component to estimating refractive error. So you not only get refractive error estimation, but you also get to see the red reflex as part of these tests. So the next is your motor evaluation. So getting your ocular motility test done and an accurate estimation of the ocular alignment. If they have strabismus, then with the best refractive correction in place, you might want to do your cover test and neutralize the strabismic deviation. Okay. So that is the next aspect. Then moving a little bit deep into the sensory testing that you would do in amblyopia, the two important tests which are going to, which is going to give you a lot of information about the depth of amblyopia and which is also going to serve as key clinical indicators when the child is on amblyopia treatment, okay, are stereopsis and Worth4Dot. So stereopsis, as you would see here, you would use a standard Randolph stereo test. And it's very, very important to be checking for both the global stereopsis, which is the random dots that are devoid of monocular cues. So use, global stereopsis when you want to really pick up the actual presence of stereopsis. Because when you use local stereopsis, like a word circle or animals, there are monocular cues that are present. So even if the child lacks binocularity, they might still be able to pass like about 1 to 2 levels of stereopsis with both your circles and animals. So it's highly recommended that we get the global stereopsis done. And even in microtropia, you might see that children may lack global stereopsis, but then they would pass local stereopsis. So it's important that you do both the estimations done. The second thing is getting your Worth4Dot test. Many of us underestimate the utility of Worth4Dot in getting the suppression, the depth of suppression in amblyopia. So, of course, all of us know that we have to do Worth4Dot at both distance, at your 6 meters and at near, like 33 centimeters to 40 centimeters. But I would also recommend that you do it under normal room light illumination as well as with your dim illumination. Now, why would you like do it under two light levels is because you want to look at how the depth of amblyopia is behaving. So, for example, a child that reports fusion under normal room light becomes diplopic under dim room light. That tells you that the fusion is not strong enough. So, in the absence of peripheral fusion cues, that the fusion breaks and the person becomes diplopic. The second thing is you can see this also, like some kids might report suppression under photopic conditions. And then when you dim the room lights off, they would be able to appreciate the Worth4Dot lights better and they will report fusion. So all these are clear indications of how well the fusion system is responding to different light levels. Because as you know, amblyopia is not just a problem in visual acuity, it's also a problem with contrast. So sometimes enhancements of contrast can facilitate the fusional response of the child. So that can also add to the response that you might get with Worth4Dot. But more than that, as you see here, when you're doing your Worth4Dot, you can get different responses. But what I want to add at this point is what I call as the Worth4Dot walkaway test. So in Worth4Dot walkaway test, what you basically do is after you do your cover test, you look for any microtropia basically. So this is a more accurate estimation for microtropia basically. So you do your unilateral cover test, and as you would know, if there is a microtropia, you're not going to be seeing any movements in your cover test. So you would go ahead and recheck with your alternate cover test. Then you do your near Worth4Dot. Okay. So in near Worth4Dot, if the child reports suppression, then of course, you know, even at 40 centimeters, somebody is reporting suppression, so you don't proceed further, you stop there. But they report fusion. Then what you do, you just keep going back and back with the handheld worth for dot. And you look at if the fusion becomes suppression at any point. So at 40 centimeters, they report 4 dots. You go to 50, you go to 1, you go to 2. And then look at if at any distance, the fusion response turns into suppression. Now here, remember that almost 70% of normal observers also report lack of, like also report suppression when you go beyond 2 meters. So when you go beyond 2 meters, because these are really tiny dots, the near worth for dot. So you will start to report suppression beyond 2 meters, which is normal. But if the person reports suppression at less than 2 meters, okay, like as you see here, even before 2 meters, if they're going to report suppression, then you go ahead and do your Bagolini test, which I will show you next. And then look for the absence of the central portion of the streak. And then you go ahead and document your stereopsis. And if you see that they have only peripheral stereopsis, then that is indicative of monofixation. Now you could ask, like, what is the relevance of you know, finding out whether they have this peripheral fusion present when it comes to clinical management? So what happens when you are like putting the child on to patching treatment, even in the absence of significant clinical clinically significant improvements in visual acuity, you might start to see that they report now, you know, fusion at more than 2 meters. I mean, they report loss of fusion at only more than 2 meters. So they might start to really show peripheral fusion at a much larger range. So earlier, even before 2 meters, they reported loss of fusion. Now they can maintain fusion even up to 2 meters. So that is again telling you, yes, there is a development of fusion, peripheral fusion that is happening. So it goes beyond just estimation of visual acuity. And this is a reference which is, I think, apparently a master's or a PhD work done at the Pacific University. So which is freely accessible. You can go and read the entire thesis where they have done this particular experiment. So as I told you, now that you do your worth for dot at 40 and say the person reports suppression at 1 meters, okay, then you go ahead and do your Bagolini. So as you see here, these are Bagolini lenses and then your specific torch, pen torch that you will use for Bagolini, and how the lenses, the light is converted into streak through these Bagolini lenses is what you see here in this picture. So the patient is holding the Bagolini and this is how they will see. So when you hold a streak of light, they're apparently supposed to be seeing 2 streaks of light that looks like an X and that cross at the center of the light source. Okay. So these are different potential responses. So as you see here, the middle one where you're seeing the light source in the center with a perfect X is indicative of fusion. Then the bottom one towards your left where you see a missing of the streak in one eye is indicative of a microtropia. So if you see this, in addition to your worth for dot walk away, then you can easily diagnose that this child has microtropia. Or if you see a complete absence of one of the streak, that's indicative of total suppression. And the top two responses are indicative of diplopia. So uncrossed and crossed diplopias. So these are different responses that you can get out of Bagolini. And Bagolini again is a very useful test because it's the least dissociating test through which you can get the sensory fusion responses under normal illumination conditions. Okay, so it's more or less close to natural viewing situation where you can get the fusional response. The next thing is, okay, now that I have done my Bagolini, I want to know what is the extent of suppression. Okay, so how deep is the suppression of the amblyopic eye? So as you see here, we can use neutral density filters. In the right corner of the PowerPoint, you can see that the patient is holding the Bagolini and then a neutral density filter is held in front of the good eye. So basically what we're trying to do, we're trying to reduce the contrast of the good eye until the patient starts to appreciate the streak in the amblyopic eye. So you're trying to reduce the competition that the good eye is giving to the amblyopic eye, and thereby you are enhancing the response of the amblyopic eye. So that's how you find the depth of suppression. So the neutral density filter will be numbered anywhere from 0, like 3 to 18. And that means anywhere from 0.3 to 1.8 log units. So that's what it indicates. And also as the log units like increase, it's also reducing the transmittance of the light. So it's slowly cutting down the amount of light that is reaching the good eye. But whereas the amblyopic eye continues to see the same intensity of the light. So let's just now see this. So suppose you're showing the bagolini and the patient sees that, I'm only seeing the line by the good eye. So the amblyopic eye's line is not visible. Okay. Then what you see is slowly increase the neutral density filter in front of the good eye. Okay. So you, and as you see here, now the contrast of the good eye is coming down, but the amblyopic eye also now starts to take part in this binocular competition. So the amblyopic eye starts to see. So when the good eye like sees really like dull, now the amblyopic eye starts to overtake. Now 1.2 log unit is the suppression, the magnitude of suppression of the amblyopic eye. So that's how you quantify the depth of suppression. And then you can keep quantifying as the patching treatment is given or any amblyopia treatment is given. You can look at how the suppression magnitude is reducing. So this is one way that you can use your bagolini along with neutral density filters to quantify suppression. The next most important test is looking for eccentric fixation. Many times we overlook this, like, you know, we don't, especially in anisometropic amblyopia, especially in high myopic or high hyperopic anisometropic amblyopia, there's always, almost always, a small microtropic component that is present. Okay. And this eccentric fixation is generally, it's present even under monocular viewing conditions. And so you have to use your director ophthalmoscope, and that's what we call as visuoscopy, to quantify the amount of eccentric fixation. So I recently came across a paper like, you know, you can even use your, the streak of your ophthalmoscope. We have the standard test is using your calibrated line target that you see here, circle and the line targets. But some people say that if you are dealing with a pre-verbal child or a child less than 3 years of age who cannot respond to this particular test, then you can even use the ophthalmoscope streak and just look into the eye basically. Like you just show a vertical streak, look into the eye and then see where the fovea is located with response to this particular streak. And this is a crude way of estimating if there is a gross eccentric fixation present or not. But the standard way of testing is to do your visuoscopy. There are four things you look when you do your direct ophthalmoscopy. Number one, you're looking at the localization, like whether it is located on the fovea or it's off the fovea. Second, if it is off the fovea, how much off? The third is it nasal to the fovea or temporal to the fovea? The last is how steady is the fixation? Is it like when you say that, look at the center of the circle. So you always say, I'm going to show this particular target. I'm going to show the circle inside your eyes. And I want you to look at the center of the middle circle. So you can even use funny words like you have to aim and shoot at the center or keep looking at the center, whatever. And then you look for the steadiness, whether the child is able to hold fixation in the center of this particular circle. And the clinical relevance is that whenever you see an eccentricity, it's assumed that for every half degree of eccentricity, visual acuity reduces by one Snellen line. So this is how you get to do this procedure. So this is basically the target. So you either project it on a table or the child's hand, and then first, you know, familiarize the child with what they're supposed to do. So you have to tell that there are many circles that you see. So this is the target that you would see in a Keeler ophthalmoscope. So you have to basically look at the middle of the center circle. So the center circle is about 2% diopters, and then everything is about 1% diopter from there on. So 2, 3, 4, 5, and you can go further than that. So usually you don't see like, you know, more than 3 or 4 prisms of eccentric fixations. That is the reason why the circle size is restricted to this. So you show this target first to the good eye always, because you want the subject to familiarize themselves to know what exactly they need to do. So when you show it to the good eye, and you will really get the fovea right on the center. And occlusion of the other eye is very important. Sometimes we forget to occlude the other eye. So you always occlude the other eye. Now here I'm just trying to look into the amblyopic eye. So the child is fixating at the center of the streak. So I'm trying to look at the steadiness, as I told you, the localization, the steadiness, the magnitude, and the direction of the eccentric fixation. So assume that this is what you see. Okay, so this is, as you know, is the image of the left eye, and you project your direct ophthalmoscope image, and then this is what you see. The yellow diamond that you see here indicates the fovea. And so if you count, so you know now that the circle is nasal to the fovea. So if the yellow diamond is where the fovea is falling, so the circle is nasal to the fovea. That's number one. Number two, how much prism diopters? As I told you, the circle is one prism diopter on either end. The whole circle is two prisms. So you have to count one towards one side. So one, two. So it's about two prism diopters of nasal eccentric fixation. Now, for a clinician, you know, we want to know, okay, now the child has about two prism diopters of eccentric fixation. Can I equate this to visual acuity? Yes, you can equate this to visual acuity. You always add one to the amount of eccentric fixation that you see. And like, so you get about like three, and that stands for the minimum angle of resolution. So you add one to the eccentric fixation and that becomes the minimum angle. To simplify this, just multiply this by 20 and that becomes 60. So 20 over 60 is the estimated visual acuity for this particular child. So when you want to write it down, you use a positive sign for nasal eccentric fixation and a negative sign. It's only for documentation. But in the formula, you always just put directly the value and then get the minimum angle of resolution, convert it into logmar acuity. Now, in this case, you are finding two prism diopters of eccentric fixation, but the visual acuity estimation is say 20-40. Okay, then either the visual acuity estimation is wrong or the eccentric fixation estimation is wrong, because generally there is a very good correlation between the amount of eccentric fixation and the drop in visual acuity. So now that you have understood this, I'm going to conduct a poll where I want you to find the estimated level of visual acuity. So I'm going to give you a eccentric fixation amount. So remember, add one to that value and then you will get the mark, and you have to convert that to logmar. That's all. So if you can multiply that by 20, you get the 60 in this case. So 20 over 60 becomes the expected visual acuity. Okay. So I'm going to run the poll now. So if a child has 3% diopters of eccentric fixation, what is the expected visual acuity for the particular child? So most of you have got it right. Perfect. It's 20 over 80 because 3 plus 1 becomes 4 minimum angle of resolution. So 4 multiplied by 20 becomes 80. So 20 over 80. So this is how you actually look at the eccentric fixation and then try to equate it to visual acuity. And this is a table that you can use it as a reference. Like if you see some amount of eccentricity, what is the equivalent visual acuity? So you will have access to this PowerPoint in the CyberSight website. So you can always take a look at it. No worries. Okay. The next thing is you can use the macular integrity tester, which is nothing but a modification of the conventional Heidinger brushes. So which is basically like the entoptic phenomena based testing, where when you look through the blue filters, you actually get to see the propeller that you see here. So here the propeller is horizontally oriented. Here it is obliquely oriented. So here it is vertically oriented. So the center, the fixation, there's a fixation point and there's a center of this propeller. So the center of the propeller serves as a tag for the fovea because it's supposed to stimulate the fovea. Okay. So wherever is the center of this propeller, compared to the fixation point, you can find out the amount of eccentric fixation. We use this quite a lot, not just in estimation of eccentric fixation, but also in the treatment process. Okay. Like to kind of break the anomalous correspondence pattern and the eccentric fixation pattern. This is a very valuable tool. The next thing is getting your accommodation assessed, because, you know, many recent studies, this is one specific study that I want you to remember, that children with amblyopia, especially unilateral amblyopia, the accommodative response is poorer in the amblyopic eye. Okay. So this has greater implication for us, because it's important to understand whether these children can, like, you know, whether they're able to read comfortably, or you know, they can have blurred vision even when the child is patched. You know, we give near activities when the child is given patching treatment, but if they have poorer accommodation response, whatever that they're trying to do could be blurred. So it's so we have to look at how to improve the accommodation response of this particular child. So if you have to assess it, then your standard monocular estimation method, retinoscopy, as you see here, our optometrist is trying to do the monocular estimation method, where she's just using lenses to look at the, to neutralize the accommodative error. Or you could use, I'm sorry, I think this is completely turned, but this is what is called as an open field autorefractor, where you can actually get the objective accommodation response from using an autorefractor. Okay, but this is a very simple clinical tool that you can always use. But what is more important is to ask the child to be reading out the letters that is written here and make sure that the child is accurately fixating. So this is one specific test that I would recommend in every unilateral amblyo to find out if there are accommodation errors. Then your low contrast visual acuity. Earlier people used to measure contrast sensitivity, but you can even use low contrast visual acuity, because during the patching treatment or any amblyopia treatment, we can look at improvements in the visual acuity. Again, just to cite the evidence, because of the issues with higher order aberrations in the amblyopic visual system, they apparently have inbuilt or inherent loss of contrast. So this is a study that looked at, if I correct these higher order aberrations and train contrast sensitivity, how does the system behave? And so this study shows the effect of perceptual learning on improving contrast sensitivity. But even otherwise, many studies have shown that you can use your vision therapy or perceptual learning to not just improve visual acuity, but also contrast sensitivity. Now, these are some of the additional measurements, but I will not go into the detail of these tests. But why is this important? I'll just tell one point at this stage, because more and more studies are coming out in this particular area that children, even when they are treated for amblyopia, they have poor reading abilities. And if you are seeing a child that says that, you know, they have struggled reading or they have some difficulty reading, it is important to look out for these abilities. And you might want to look at additional strategies that can help them, like, you know, using either more spaced letters or more, you know, using specific lined books. Or when they want to, like, large font books, you might just think that they have good near vision, so they might be able to read well. But because of the crowding, it is important to remember that the reading ability can be impaired. Now, just I will, finish my presentation with overview of how do we manage amblyopia. The overall, now that we have done testing, we have assessed monocular and binocular functions. Overall goal of amblyopia is, of course, to improve monocular and binocular visual functions. And the prognosis, as we all know, is dependent on very many factors, including age, vision, cause and severity of amblyopia, duration and compliance. And so before I just summarize that, I want to take a poll at this point to know your understanding of the current evidence that's used in the amblyopia treatment. You know, all of us are aware of the PEDIC studies that have, I think, currently it's on study number 20 or 21. So they've come out with n number of results that has standardized the way that people treat amblyopia. So in this particular case, if you're seeing a five-year-old child with anisometropic amblyopia with plano in refractive error in one eye and minus six in the other, what would you do? Will you prescribe full correction and start part-time patching? Or you will prescribe full correction and start full-time patching? Or you would only give spectacles and review at 6 to 8 weeks? Or you would give half, like, you know, say minus three or minus four and start part-time. Which one would you choose? And you can just, you know, choose whichever that you are currently following or you feel is more appropriate for this particular case. Okay, so there does seem to be a wide variation in the response as I expected. And many of you would want to prescribe full correction and start part-time occlusion. Okay. And some of you would want to prescribe full correction and review at 6 to 8 weeks. Okay. So what is recommended from evidence basically is to only prescribe glasses and review at 6 to 8 weeks and not do anything. Okay. The reason is because I'm not getting into the detail of this particular, the entire PEDIC protocols, but this is an outline. So generally you don't do anything. You only prescribe full refractive correction, even if the amblyopia is moderate, follow up every 6 to 8 weeks. And if the visual acuity improves by more than 2 lines, you just keep continuing the refractive adaptation. But if the visual acuity plateaus or if the improvement is not happening as expected, then we initiate part-time occlusion. Okay, and the initiation is usually only part-time, 2 to 6 hours. And then when maximum visual acuity is achieved, then you can taper the treatment. Now, what I recommend people who are listening to this lecture is to go and listen to another lecture where this entire treatment is so nicely summarized by Dr. Jameel. So she has done this presentation, I think, very recently, where the entire PEDIC protocol with case examples she's dealt with. So if you go listen to this particular presentation in this link, you will get to know as why I told that way, like, you know, go ahead with only refractive adaptation. But now that you've started refractive adaptation, and if you want to, you know, start any therapy for amblyopia, then this is the whole sequence. You know, if any of you want to listen more in detail, you can send your feedback and we can do a full lecture only on this alone. But if you look at the gross steps, whenever we treat any amblyopic patient, our goal is to start with full refractive correction, improve monocular functions, go improve peripheral fusion, then go improve foveal fusion, then establish binocular vision in free space and start a home maintenance program. So this is a general vision therapy protocol that we follow. And some of the protocols that we use goes like this. We start what is called as the MIBF or monocular and binocular field, go to biocular treatments, binocular and intersensory integration. So just to give you a feel of why do we actually talk about vision therapy or even any advanced treatments in amblyopia management, even when there are not really well established evidence for some of these innovations. Mainly when we deal with these children, we know that compliance issues are always there when we put these children on patching. And there are well-established evidence that children have who are on patching develop allergic reaction. There are, you know, social stigma and quality of life issues and peer pressure and other things associated with patching. And if the child is put on atropine penalization and then they have allergic reaction and photosensitivity issues, and when you are able to provide some of these innovative treatments, you're able to reduce the treatment duration, you're able to engage the child much more, especially when it comes to younger. When it comes to older, you have very limited window for visual acuity to be improved. So it's always better to be more aggressive with your treatment, and you're able to achieve just beyond improving visual acuity, you're able to achieve improvements in stereopsis, improvements in fusion. And these treatment modalities have kind of revolutionize the follow-up of treatment. Like, you can, the clinician can sit at one end, the patient can undergo the treatment at the other end, and you will be able to remotely follow up the improvements in the vision. So that's the reason why some of these inventions are, like, you know, this is some of the studies that have been published very recently about the importance of dioptric based video treatments. Or even, you know, this study is a very well conducted study where they have looked at contrast rebalanced movies. Like, remember this Bagolini test that we did, where we purposefully dim the contrast of the good eye. So the same principle is used in these vision therapy also, where you purposefully reduce the contrast of the good eye such that the eye is able to work together, binocular summation is happening, and you're able to improve binocularity along with visual acuity. Now, the important thing is, in this particular study, in 2 weeks of treatment, they have been able to achieve the same result that with occlusion therapy that the child was able to achieve with 3 to 4 months. There were two groups. One was put on occlusion, the other was put on binocular gaze. So within 2 weeks, you're able to achieve something which otherwise is going to take you 4 months. So I think it's important that we relook at some of these treatment modalities. As I told you, I don't have any financial disclosures, but these are some of the advances that you can go ahead and look. One of that is REMED virtual reality. The second is Binox, which is again based on dioptric based video games. The third is what is called as Revital Vision, where it's based on Garbot patch based images to stimulate the lateral interactions as well as binocularity. So when do we use all this is in this particular case where this child was poorly compliant to patching for almost like 2 years, the patching was done. Visual acuity did not improve beyond 6/12. When the child was shifted to dioptric treatment in 10 sessions, 1 hour per day, visual acuity improved to 6/7.5 and stereopsis also improved. So these are real examples of some of our children who improved with these treatments. The second, again, a 12-year-old who had both microtropia and anisometropic amblyopia, basically combined mechanism. Again, visual acuity was plateaued. We started with virtual reality based therapy. Again, in 10 sessions, visual acuity improved. So these therapies kind of, you know, help you to get rid of the plateaus that you would be struggling otherwise in amblyopia treatments. This is like a kit that I just wanted to show you all the testing that we discussed so far, like which has your, you know, stereopsis, your near worth for dot foveal, especially the smaller targets, your Bergolini, importance of accommodation testing, your anomalous, I didn't get go into detail of anomalous correspondence due to the time, and your standard visual acuity charts, some of the references. And I take this opportunity to invite all of you to our upcoming International Vision Science and Optometry Conference in August, between 13th to 16th, happening in Chennai. So you can go into our website, eof2020.org, to learn more. There are many more topics and many more hands-on workshops that you get to attend. So even ophthalmologists who are attending this session can see if you can send your optometrist to, you know, get trained in a variety of areas. And any other further feedback or topics that you want to cover, you can email me as well as CyberSite, Ms. Sushweta. Thank you, everybody, for your patient listening.